and welcome to the Motor Show here at Birmingham's National Exhibition Centre. This is the 67th, arguably the best yet. There are something like 600 different exhibitors here on 500 stands, so if you're thinking about coming, then you really should find something to take your eye. The doors, in fact, open to the public this weekend, and the show, in a sense, points up our love affair with the car in this country. At least 60% of British households these days owns one or more. Now then, there are some familiar stars here. There's nothing, though, to match the excitement or the air of expectation surrounding the launch of a new model. First all-new Aston for 20 years. That's no mean achievement. You must be a pretty proud man.
I'm a very proud man at what my team have achieved in getting this motor car to this superb state, and a motor car that we feel is quintessentially an Aston Martin.
So what's especially Aston about it? I must say it looks like one, but convince me.
Well, I think that the great thing about it is that we wanted an all-new shape, we wanted a new form, we wanted people to be able to look at it, to see reminiscent things of the older models, even going back to the DB4, and the other aspects of it, of the power, the performance, the safety. And of course the full drawing room effect, bands of Connolly leather and nice burr walnut.
I was just about to ask, does it smell like an Aston?
Oh, absolutely.
So Ford, well, 75% they own of your company now. Has the money helped, to be honest?
Well, I think the money hasn't actually been involved in the last year in getting this motor car out, but it sure as hell helped the morale. And that's a big factor when you're batting away at a project like this.
On the Ford stand this year, the news is less about cars and more about car production, because this is the week in which Ford have announced plans to expand their engine production plant at Bridge End, which is going to create many more jobs. But of course, Ford don't need to make news, they make cars that sell. The top three best-selling cars in Britain, the Escort, the Sierra and the Fiesta, are all Ford, so perhaps this year they're just basking in a bit of reflective glory. But they have come up with something a bit different with this new Orion. It's the same outside, it's when you open the door that you can see and smell the difference, because it's got a leather and wood interior, courtesy of Aston Martin Tickford, who of course Ford now own. This is the Orion 1600E, which is a numbering series that harks back to the good old days of the Cortina, which was a nice little motor, real boy racer stuff. But you need to be a boy racer with a bit of cash for this one, because it markets at £12,500. So for that price, I can't really see anyone putting the black vinyl roof on it. Also on the Ford stand this year are concept cars, the cars of the future. Particularly impressive is the aerodynamically sound Probe. Ford make very successful cars of the present, so perhaps we should look to them for a glimpse of possibly our motoring future.
Here on the Vauxhall stand, it's immediately apparent that they're out for Ford's blood. It's the biggest stand at the motor show. There's 38 cars here on display. But the car that most people will come to see is the new Vauxhall Cavalier. It was launched back in August, so the shape's quite familiar, but there's two new versions we haven't seen before. One is the GSI 2000, that's the 16-valve hot performance version of the range. And the other is the new 4x4. The four-wheel drive version is creating a lot of interest here at the motor show, because Vauxhall haven't pitched it as an expensive option. They've made the four-wheel drive available on the L version of the car, and that makes it an affordable company car. But you don't want to hear me wittering on about the new Vauxhall. Let's go out on the road with the family and see what they thought of it.
When I got in the car, I felt at home straight away in it. The steering, I hadn't realised that it was power assisted, because I felt it was that positive. The gearbox, I felt, was very smooth for a transverse engine, because generally you get a little bit of notchiness, but this was very, very smooth indeed. And the road holding, I found, was extremely good. I throw it into corners and it stayed there very, very nicely.
It's the biggest car that I've ever driven. I've never driven anything bigger than a 1600 before. But it was just so easy. It didn't sort of run away with me, but it was responsive. I just really enjoyed driving it. I have no real criticisms to make of the car. So long as I can drive it and feel comfortable in it, I'm happy. And I was happy.
Travelling at speed is very deceptive. Travelling at 70 miles an hour, I thought it was only doing about 50. I would imagine that it would be very, very easy to be going a lot faster and not realising it. Very, very little wind noise, which made it all the more pleasurable to drive.
Part of the Vauxhall philosophy in creating the new Cavalier is to make it easier to maintain, and that's good news for owners and garages. The headlamp adjustment, for instance, is now a simple screw on top of the unit instead of messing about with adjusters at the back here. The oil filter is readily accessible. The garages will like to hear that it's now very easy to change the timing belt. In the past, that was a major operation on a Cavalier. Vauxhall also say the car's going to be a lot easier to repair at the front end after a minor accident. Now, they've also paid a lot of attention to safety, and the doors feature clever flanges that ensure that in a bad accident, the doors will never jam together and lock, and that could save people's lives. Vauxhall have been very pleased with the performance of their British assembly plants of late. At one stage, it looked as though British assembly for Vauxhall could be under threat. But now they're making 70% of all cars they sell in the UK. But like all British car makers, their eyes are firmly fixed on a Japanese plant in the north of the country.
The first Nissan Bluebird due for export to Europe rolled off the production lines at Sunderland at the end of September and straight into a storm. Because that's at least what one of those European markets, France, had been expecting, that the Japanese, who previously had not been able to sell in their market, would set up a base in Britain and then start to, well, drown them, for want of a better word. Because despite all the various rules and regulations on restrictions of trade in the EEC, the Japanese had previously received the resounding no. The French still managed to get away with picking and choosing what will and won't be sold in their country. But despite all of that, Nissan are undeterred, and they tell us that by 1991, at least 40% of the 100,000 or so cars coming out of Sunderland will be for the European export market. It's not just the British-built Bluebird that Nissan are proudly showing off here this week. There's also this, the new 200SX, which comes into the range to replace the old, well-respected, it has to be said, Silvia. And it's a very timely addition too, with Nissan sales worldwide down all round this year. Many of the same specifications as the Silvia. They stay with the rear-wheel drive. Looks a little bit, actually, like the old 300ZX, doesn't it? And inside the bonnet, 1.8-litre turbo engine, four valves per cylinder. Nice car.
Cars, that's what it's all about here, yeah? Self-promotion. But Citroën have got more reason to be confident than most. Since 1985, when their sales figures were hovering around the 28,000 mark, they're expected to reach the 70,000 mark this year and corner 3% of the market. Last year, the Citroën VX diesel was the biggest selling diesel at the show. This year, no change, it's still holding the baton. And they're hoping it's going to be the same sort of success story with the diesel version of the AX, which doesn't come out until next spring. Now, the AX, of course, is an extremely popular car, so they're hoping to see a great many of the diesel versions on the road. Citroën are Britain's fastest-growing car company, so it really is a success story all round.
And another French name that's fast becoming the success story of the British motor industry is Peugeot. They're now churning them out by the thousand from their Coventry assembly plant. The latest model is the new 405 Estate. Now, Peugeot have gone for a very squared off rear end to the car, and that's a distinct advantage in an estate car because it means you can load it right up to the roof line. If they'd chosen a more sloping tail, you waste space. There's also a tremendous amount of space between the wheel arches, almost the best in its class. As you'd expect, an asymmetrically split rear seat, and the whole thing folds down to a double bed, which at a motor show is a very good idea.
Renault's new 19 is one of the stars of their stand. It goes on sale in this country next March. The designers have stuck basically to the, well, almost too familiar teardrop shape, but this car, like Fiat's Tipo, rather sturdier than they've tended to be in recent years. Now, the theory behind that is that car buyers these days are not perhaps looking for the ultimate fuel economy performance from their car, but rather more substance. So this and the Tipo, in a sense, breaking new ground. It comes with a range of engines, including a new 16-valve unit. Nice sound. Certainly feels as though there's plenty of space in here. And it's finished very nicely too, but then so it should be. This one's the top of the range. Fairly standard fascia, although there is one very important safety feature. It's possible to raise or lower the sound of the radio and change channels without taking your hands off the wheel or your gaze off the road. Renault have had their problems recently, but it looks as though they'll build on the success of the 21 with this. But how does it handle? Well, Chris has been having one.
It's crucial for the future of Renault that this car wins the hearts and minds of its target market. And in this country in particular, they desperately need to convince fleet managers and buyers that the 19 will be perceived as an acceptable package, both from the point of view of reliability and pricing. Of course, drivability will be paramount.
You have to say that the ride and handling on the new 19 is absolutely superb. You can throw the car at a corner and it neither understeers excessively nor does it break away. It proves the car's absolutely on your side in an emergency situation.
All the controls are light and precise and they're well laid out. The gear change is slick and easy, the driving position good, the steering light and the pedals in exactly the right place. It's an easy car to drive and live with. But of course, it's up against some of the fiercest competition on the European car market.
There's been more of a move towards lead-free petrol in the country this year. Those green nozzle pumps are far more a common sight at service stations now with their economy price tags. And by 1990, of course, all petrol engine cars will have to have the option to run lead-free. Still, sadly, only 10% of our 21,000 service stations are stocking the fuel. So if you've had your car converted, either for economy or ecological reasons, that can be a minor irritation. If your car only runs lead-free, now that is a major problem. Toyota currently markets two of those, the GT4, which we saw launched earlier this year, this particular car, the four-wheel drive turbo version. But they've also got a new car, especially for the show, this motorway monster, the Supra, with its lazy 3-litre engine and its tall, relaxed gearing. Now, Toyota are aware of our problems regards availability in this country. They've thought, though, of absolutely everything. As far as availability problems in this country are concerned, they provide completely free of charge this rather natty little jerry can into which you can pour 5 litres of unleaded fuel for those emergency occasions. Because make no mistake, once you've put leaded petrol into this car, and there are various safeguards to ensure that that doesn't happen, well, you will ruin an extremely expensive catalyst, and ironically, you'll be pumping out rather more pollution than you might ordinarily be. Well, Jimmy McRae, 5 times British Open Rally Champion, you take delivery of your GT4 at the weekend. You must be looking forward to that.
Yes, we've done quite a bit of testing with it, and really enthusiastic about the car.
Now, you've been very loyal to the two-wheel drive for a long time now, to the Metro aside. What sort of difference is this going to provide for you?
Well, the fact that it's a turbocharged car, it's four-wheel drive, and obviously in the very slippy conditions of the Lombardy RAC, you know, this is what we need.
Why have we waited so long when it's been doing a lot of good work elsewhere across Europe?
I think they originally, you know, to get the car homologated and get the car working well, it costs a lot of money, and I think, you know, Toyota GB have left it up to Japan to do that. Then, you know, now the car is successful, they have stepped in and going to have an onslaught in the Lombard RAC.
We're not all rally fans, of course, and there's big news on the family saloon front with Fiat's new Tipo. Launched earlier this year, but only now reaching the dealer showrooms in any numbers, the Tipo is aimed at the escort golf sector of the marketplace. It's a notable Fiat for the solidity of the design. It's heavier than many of its rivals, with a stronger body shell and heavier doors. The company reckons that people have had enough of ultra-light, tinny-feeling cars and are now looking for more substance.
It's got more interior space than its rivals, and it's also notable for the attention paid to that old Fiat bugbear, rust. It's unique in the market in this class by using galvanized steel for all exterior panels. Fiat is keen on being number one in Europe, and on the eve of the show, it announced a deal with Chrysler to sell its Alfa Romeo cars in America. But in Europe, its main rival is Volkswagen.
Well, if I can't afford to buy one, I might as well take up washing them, I suppose. The motor show isn't all about shiny cars and shiny trucks and shiny buses, but there's also a large accessory hall at the back there, and if you're coming to the motor show, make sure you go for a walk around it, because there's some fascinating things on display. This caught my eye. It's a bucket and a tube and a brush, and when you shake it, the water comes out and you wash the car, and when you stop shaking it, the water stops. I think it's a brilliant little idea, and it's ever so cheap. But there's a lot of other things around there to have a look at. Now, amongst the other little gems we found on the stands is this marvellous little kettle. If you fancy a brew up on the lay-by and James can't get you one in a hurry, this plugs into the cigar lighter socket, and they tell me it doesn't take very long to boil. We also found a handbrake lock. I know they're not new, but I think they're very important, especially if you're going to leave kids in the car whilst you're doing your shopping. Kids obviously play with the controls. They could conceivably let the handbrake off with disastrous results. And another product I'm not quite so sure about. We found this tire grip product. The idea is if you're stuck on snow or ice, you simply spray the product on your tires. It gives you instant grip and you can get going again. Now, it really works. It does give you grip and it moves your way in an emergency. I'm worried that people will then rely on the extra grip. It'll run out and they'll find themselves in trouble a few miles down the road.
Still with accessories, the extras on this car are the result of a competition organised between the Daily Express and Vauxhall to find out what their women readers and therefore women drivers would like to see in a car. What emerged was that a lot of the ideas suggested are already on the market, which only goes to show that the advertising must be aimed at men, or they'd know that. Like this inflatable jack, it's a very simple idea. You simply stick it under the car and inflate it, and the whole thing rises up because there's a tube connected to the exhaust, so when you start the car engine, the bag fills with exhaust air, and hey presto, your car lifts. This is a good idea too, and something like it is already on the market. It's a wheel nut spanner with an extendable arm, so you get a lot more purchase on it. I'm sure everybody would appreciate that who's ever tried to loosen wheel nuts in a tricky situation. On the key fob is what's claimed to be an alarm device. Now, this is a prototype, it's not making an awful lot of noise, and I can't believe that even if it was, people would take much notice of it as an alarm. But it would be a good idea if you lost your car in a good car park and you wanted to find it again and own up. I bet that's happened to you. Inside the car, I think things fall down a little. Obviously, somebody somewhere wants a hairdryer in their car, but I can't believe everybody does, and one this size isn't going to be an awful lot of good to you. But that's a good idea. The bag on the front of the passenger seat for keeping all your bits in, and I seem to remember that that same thing was suggested with the competition last year. It's about time, I think, that manufacturers stop thinking about women drivers and men drivers and just drivers in general and the practicalities of motoring, and perhaps then we'd actually see a few of these ideas in production.
The mood on the Hyundai stand is anything to go by. The Koreans plainly in aggressive marketing mood, and indications for the first time at this motor show that they plan to move away from the bargain basement image they may have with the Pony to the new executive middle class range that's developed with the arrival of their new car, the Sonata. Hyundai are aiming this car at the sort of people that might ordinarily buy Vauxhall's Carlton or Ford's Granada. It comes with all the usual executive bits and pieces on board, but one has to say you don't quite get the feeling of style in the cockpit. One thing Hyundai have produced on is their promise to dramatically undercut the opposition. This car comes in at between £10,000 and £12,000. Their own styling department is responsible for the shape. It comes with a choice of transmissions, a 5-speed manual box or a 4-speed automatic. Choice of three engines, a 1.8, a 2-litre or a 2.4. All fuel injected, and the company tell us they've gone for lightly stressed computer controlled engines, which perhaps provide for more flexible power than they do a good meaty performance.
Just when you thought there were enough cars on the roads, another new name is about to be launched. It's Proton, available as from next spring. They've been made in Kuala Lumpur for the last 3 years because they're the result of a deal between the Mitsubishi car company in Japan and Malaysia. They'll come in a fairly standard range of saloon and hatchback at prices from about 6,000 to 8,500 on the road. And I'm not going to make myself dizzy looking at the one on the stand, but there is one on the deck here to have a closer look inside. Any Mitsubishi driver will recognise the fascia immediately. It hasn't changed, although the seat trim is in fact Malaysian, so that's different. And the sunroof, for some reason, has been positioned on the outside of the car. The show's organisers obviously approve of these. They've given the stand 2 gold medals and a silver, no less. And the manufacturers hope to sell 5,000 next year and 10,000 the year after, which seems an optimistic forecast. But if the show's organisers are anything to go by, who knows? They might even make it.
As you travel up and down the country listening to the increasingly sophisticated radios manufacturers are fitting, you'll have come across the problem that VHF has limited range and the station fades the further you go, and you're constantly having to fiddle to retune the radio. Volvo will be one of the first manufacturers in the country to fit RDS, which is a new system developed in conjunction with the BBC. It automatically retunes the radio as you travel, and it also lets travel information come in when they're broadcast to keep you updated on your route. Now, one thing it doesn't do is tell you how to get to your destination, and that's something electronic manufacturers are looking at. Bosch has put the roadmap of Britain and the street map of every town with more than 100,000 people in on one compact disc, and they're using this as the heart of their new system. Now, I don't think I'm bad at navigation, but there's something about Birmingham. Whenever I get into the city centre, I get lost. I can find my way up here to the Bullring all right, but from then on I always seem to take the wrong exit for some reason. Now, to get to the NEC, I know I need the Aston Expressway. I've got a device in this car, though, that's designed to help people like me. Now, the principle of the system is quite simple. This flashing arrow shows exactly where I am, and as you can see, I'm into the Bullring system. Now, it'll also display where I said I want to go, and that will be indicated as a star on the map. And there we are, there's my destination. At the top of the screen, the arrow tells me which direction it would like me to go in, and here it's flicked to the left, so I'll follow it round to the left. If I want a bit more detail of the roads, I press the reduction button, and there we're on a half mile, which gives me a much more detailed information on where we are. And again, I can come down to a quarter scale map, and this gives me some idea of the street names, and here's the roundabout we're just approaching at this second. Now, the system will be available for business and private users towards the end of next year. It'll cost between £1,500 and £2,000. And the compact discs themselves will be regularly updated. And each time you buy a new one, it'll cost you around about £50. At the moment, the system purely operates as a map. But in future, it'll also be integrated into traffic information systems. So it'll be able to absorb where there's traffic jams, road accidents and road works. And there we are, here comes the Aston Expressway, and the NEC, here we come.
There's always a big crowd around any sports car stand, and this year there's a lot of interest at the stand of a familiar name in the sports car world, Reliant. Now, with an eye to expanding markets here, and particularly in the States, they've come up with this. It's a prototype at the moment. It was designed by the British designer William Townes, who I suppose you could describe as a British Ajaro. I think it's very nice indeed, very clean lines, very simple. I'm afraid you'll have to hold your breath somewhat if you want one, though, because it won't be available here until 1990. But you could beat the rush and go over to the States and pick one up there at the end of next year.
Now, you might think we're still on the Reliant stand with rather an outdated motor car, but in fact, we're on the Middlebridge Engineering stand, and this is a brand new car at the show. Middlebridge is a new company. They bought the rights to the old Reliant Scimitar. They've set up a new factory in Nottingham, and they're remanufacturing the car because they think a demand exists for it. They've been right through it. There's over 450 modifications to the old design. They've redone the suspension, the wheels, the bodywork. They're putting the new Ford Scorpio 2.9-litre V6 in it with a 5-speed manual gearbox, and they've retrimmed the interior. The price, well, it's going to be between £23,000 and £24,000, depending on specification, and that's an awful lot more than the old Scimitar. But they're sure that they're going to sell between 100 and 200 cars a year. Now, the man behind Middlebridge Engineering is a Japanese businessman, Mr. Koji Nakauchi. What are the future plans?
This Scimitar project should close within 5 years. Then we make our own sports car.
So you'll make a sports car in England?
Yes.
That you'll export back to Japan?
Yes.
And that's
worth... Yes, I'd like to help your trade gap.
The cars look very good, but it's when you get in here that you start running out of adjectives, because this is the biggest hall at the NEC and it's the home of the real big guys, all the trucks and vans. Truck manufacture is often thought of as a contest between companies like Leyland DAF and Ford Iveco, but many of the other manufacturers are attracting a good deal of public interest and attention. And you see what I mean about adjectives, because you couldn't just describe this as big, could you? But with this impressive looking vehicle, we're not talking about size, but what goes on behind here. AWD, the manufacturers, have developed a coupling system designed to reduce the turning circle of large trucks, basically using a multi-drive system whereby the wheels of the trailer are both steered and driven. They've reduced that turning circle by 60% over a comparable rigid vehicle. They've developed it, of course, for highway and off-highway use, and what it means to you and me is that we're less likely to sit behind a truck trying to manoeuvre itself into a tight space. Now this is more like it, out on the open road, a bar of chocolate of course, but there's nothing like getting behind the wheel to actually drive a vehicle out. It really tests you, it makes such a difference to the whole feel of the thing.
Clutch.
Thanks Kim, another illusion shattered. But there has been some driving going on, and it's driving with a capital D. The Ferrari F40, strangely enough, hasn't been road tested up till now off an Italian road, but that lucky and speedy man, Chris Goffey, got to try it out. Clutch.
Essentially, the F40 is quite a simple device. Behind here, a 3-litre V8 twin turbocharged engine developing almost 500 brake horsepower. Inside, two racing seats, no frills, just this very high-tech composite material that welds the chassis tubes together. The car is an out-and-out racer for the road. The Ferrari is all about power, so let's open it up and see what it does. The push in the back as you accelerate in the gears is phenomenal. And the sheer cornering power is fantastic. When they told me I was going to drive the F40, I approached it with a somewhat cynical frame of mind. They're never going to race this car, and it's not really a road car. It's a thinly disguised racing car, and it's just built for very rich enthusiasts who can indulge the ultimate ambition. But in fact, when you get in this car and you start to drive it, the magic just flows through the controls. The steering wheel is alive in your hands. The throttle response is electrifying.
Well, it's 40 years now since this, the very first Land Rover, was launched onto the market at the 48 Amsterdam show. Since then, it's become one of the legends of the British motor industry. It's travelled to virtually every corner of the world and proven itself to be almost indestructible. The only two countries never to have sold a Land Rover? Albania and North Vietnam. And not a lot of people know that. These days, the Land Rover star is this, the Range Rover, which is shortly to celebrate its 20th anniversary. And it's doing very nicely as well, thank you. UK sales are up so far this year, 23%, and it's the same story on all the export markets, particularly in America, where the car was launched last year. And after 20 years, that's a story in itself. Well, in keeping with its somewhat Park Lane image, and Land Rover will tell you that most of these cars rarely get their wheels dirty, there's been a number of improvements internally. There's a nice walnut trim, leather seats, leather steering wheel cover as well. It's fully air conditioned, 6-speaker stereo system, 4 in the front and 2 in the back. Oh, and there's an electric sunroof as well. All these things on this one, the Vogue SE, come as standard. The only optional extra is the telephone. All that, and they've rather let themselves down with a rather cheap cassette box. There's been another change too in the transmission, but we'll have to go and find another one of these to show you that. If there's been one consistent complaint about the Range Rover down the years, it's been the noisy transmission. Well, they think they're over that problem with the introduction of a new chain system. There's also a far better distribution of the power between the four wheels. One other significant change as well down the years. Originally new, this would have cost you £2,000. Nowadays, it's worth very nearly £28,000. Perhaps this one's going half price.
Well, here on the Volkswagen stand, the centre of interest for the family man at least is the newly announced Passat, and in particular the estate version. Now, there's 5 versions of the estate, but this is the hot one, the GT 16 valve. It's powered by the 2-litre engine, developing 136 brake horsepower, and that's enough to allow it to go to 124 miles an hour and at the same time carry half a tonne. It's a perfect example of what they call in the industry niche marketing. You try and find a slot for your car where there's the least competition. Now, whoever's in that slot is going to be pretty well off, because Volkswagen want £16,000 for this baby. At the centre, though, of the star of the Volkswagen show is this little device. It's a spiral supercharger, and it allows the 1.8-litre engine to develop 160 brake horsepower in the latest car. And this is it, the Corrado. It's a 3-door, 4-seater sports car that takes Volkswagen into a new sector of the market. It's the fastest car they've ever built. In supercharged form, it'll do 140 miles an hour. It's not going to be cheap either. It's going to cost around £20,000. Now, the Corrado features a movable aerodynamic device at the back. The spoiler in Germany is set to come up at 75 miles an hour to make the car more stable. Now, the British importers immediately realised this meant that nobody would legally see the spoiler move in Great Britain. So over here, it's been reset to come up at 45 miles an hour, and it really doesn't have too much of an effect. Now, we've seen a lot of high-performance hot hatchbacks here at the NEC, and the insurance companies will tell you they're in particular a very bad risk. As many as half of them could be involved in some sort of accident or claim during their insurance lives. Too many people fetching up against the wall. Now, do manufacturers therefore have a responsibility to ensure that the people buying their hot hatchbacks are capable of driving them? Volkswagen's one company that's recently instituted a series of high-performance driving courses. Now, we're doing, 75 now in fifth, approaching this corner.
Yes, still carry on. Start slowing the car down on the brakes now, come back into full.
Well, let me show you my cornering technique, and you tell me what's wrong with it. Yep. That was all right.
Very impressive. I mean, really, far too many revs going in. Totally, white knuckle job, hanging on there, used far too much road, and really, typical of a boy racer. Just, car was really badly balanced and very uncomfortable for the passenger. This time, I want you to slow the car down on the brakes, come down into fourth gear, remembering we're only using half of the road, into third, back on the power, and progressively bringing more power through the corner and power out of the corner and onto the straight. Possibly just the same speed as we was doing before, much more relaxed, much smoother, much better for your passenger, and certainly more impressive for me.
The course is available through VW dealers at around £300. That sounds a lot of money, but if it helps avoid an accident or injury, it might well be worth it.
There's a chance for you to actually win a car at the motor show this year. Every year, Britain's motoring journalists choose the top car out of a choice of a possible 10. Have a look at those 10, they're coming up in a moment, and if you get the order of the first 4 right, you could be driving along in the top car.
Well, this year there's a chance for both visitors to the motor show here and Radio Times readers to enter the competition. If you're coming to the show, have a look round at the top 10 cars the journalists have nominated, then try and place them in the order that you think they will. If you're not coming to the show, then it's page 20 of this week's Radio Times for you. If you get the top 4 correct, and then offer up the best tie-break reason for doing so, then you win the top car. It's as simple as that. Interesting that Audi should use the motor show to launch their new coupe. It's a three-door version of a combination, really, of the 80 and 90 saloons. It's either two-wheel or four-wheel drive. Two engine types, the 2.2 or the 2.3 20-valve version. The coupe, of course, has always been a popular design in Britain. This one's likely to continue the trend for a number of reasons. Perhaps the space that it provides internally. Most coupes tend to be a 2+2, but there really is enough space in here for four adults to sit more than comfortably. As is the case with all Audis, the body is galvanised, so you should get a long-term investment on your money, nearly £28,000.
The Volvo 440 won't be on sale in Britain until the spring of next year, but Volvo are giving potential owners the opportunity of a preview here at the NEC. Now, the 440 is based on the floor pan of the 480 sports car, but it's a five-door hatchback, and Volvo are emphasising that it won't be a replacement for the old 300 series car. That will continue. The 440 takes them into a new sector of the market. Inside the 440, there's lots of leg and headroom, but they've achieved it by putting the seats very close to the floor pan of the car. And especially in the back, that means there's not quite so much support for the underneath of the thighs you might want. There's a lot of British influence on the 440. IAD of Worthing did the body design, and the Lotus Group helped out with the engineering of the suspension. But the power plant itself is also very interesting. It's a perfect example of the complex interrelationships between today's manufacturers. This engine is actually built by Renault for Volvo. It's the Renault 21 engine, but it's to Volvo specifications. This is the top-of-the-range turbocharged engine. It delivers 118 brake horsepower, and there's also a carburetor 88 brake horsepower version.
And from four wheels to a man who made a reputation on two. Barry Sheen, who lives in Australia, of course, now. I see you look extremely fit and well. Australia plainly suits you.
Oh, it's so nice. I spoke to my wife this morning. It's first 2 weeks of spring and it's 33 degrees.
Do you miss us? Do you miss us?
Well, I miss you guys, but no, I really don't miss too much. Marks and Spencer's food store and that's about it.
You left, of course, for health reasons. Are you still setting off the airport security alarms? You told me a lovely story about that once.
No, I don't get in trouble now. I had all the metal out of my legs at the end of, what was it, 85. So down there, it's perfect. You know, the weather's so warm, I don't get any aches and pains, and just feel healthy.
And what are you up to?
I got a contract with Channel 9 television and do the commentaries on the bike Grand Prix and the upcoming Australian Formula 1 Grand Prix. I should be doing interviews and that in the pits. Bit of commercial property, bit of wheeling and dealing. You know how it is.
I know how it is. Quick word about the motor show. Anything especially taking your eye?
I think, the new Jaguar obviously looks very good. The new Aston Martin's nice. I think the whole presentation of it, every time I come here, it gets better and more professional. Well, I think that now, technology-wise, they're using a lot of things that it's like flying someone to the moon. They said no one would ever go to the moon, but they had concept cars with four-wheel steering, and everybody said, what is this, some kind of joke? Now Honda's still a car with four-wheel steering. So I think that the technology out of Formula One racing and that, it's got to go into the road cars, and it's got to be good because it's a good, strong start.
Good to see you. Keep smiling. Enjoy Australia.
I will.
It's a cold winter this year. We've all heard the problems that might ensue from an alleged world shortage of antifreeze. Well, this British company, Kenlo, has come up with what could be the answer to a lot of people's problems. It's a water heater. You simply insert it in the heater hose and bolt it to the side of the engine bulkhead. 20 minutes before you go off in the morning, you switch it on. It warms up the car's cooling system to just about the right temperature. And then when you come out, you get in the car, switch on, and just drive away with a nice warm engine. And that means that the heater works, the demister works, you're nice and comfortable. And it's much better for your car because you haven't had a cold start, you've saved all the petrol through having the choke out, and you've saved the wear from having cold oil. Device costs £78, and you can fit it yourself.
Some four-wheel drive vehicles have had a bit of a bad press recently, but they're still a very fast-growing market. Daihatsu are delighted to have had the world international launch of their new sport track vehicle here at the NEC. It comes in the hardtop version, like this one, or a soft removable top, and it's designed to fill that gap in the market between road-going cars and the genuine off-road working sort. Now, with this in mind, some other manufacturers have begun to adapt their existing models. They're Renault with the Espace Quadro and Honda with the Civic Shuttle, but the best way to see them is to see them going through their paces. Both of these cars are unaffected in performance by the adaptations. In fact, if anything, they're improved, with four-wheel drive giving extra confidence and, of course, extra stability in crosswinds. They're both very comfortable, especially the Espace. To be successful, though, they've got to cope with bad weather conditions and extremes of terrain. The combination of a steep hill and wet conditions is quite a challenge, and the Espace coped remarkably well. It could do with a bit more ground clearance, though, and the front spoiler looks a bit vulnerable. It was eventually defeated, but with proper off-road tyres, it could have coped easily. The Honda did well, too, and has the benefit of an extra-low crawler gear. It was also less vulnerable at the front, but like the Espace, could do with a bit more ground clearance. Both vehicles have powerful engines, but they're both a bit lacking in the necessary pulling power for off-road work. It's clear they both handle and perform well off-road. But what about the interiors of the vehicles? The Espace offers a lot of room with the seats removed, but perhaps it's a bit too plush for the sort of mud and grime you'd expect with off-road driving. The Honda doesn't have anything like the same capacity, and it too is perhaps a bit too smart, though it does have rubber mats in the interior wells. If you need a comparison, just look what happened to the camera car. It's an ordinary Espace, and it's stuck pretty firmly at the edge of the field as the Quadra sped past it. So if you happen to live at the top of a particularly rough farm track, this would be convincing enough proof.
The Jaguar XJ220. There's only one in the world, and this is it. It's a glorious beast, far exceeding all the expectations. We thought we were in for something a bit special, but we didn't expect this when it was unveiled last Tuesday.
So it gives me great pleasure now, with Jim Randall, our chief engineer, to unveil this beautiful car. And I do hope you like it. Thank you.
The XJ220. She's based on the XJR9 Group C car, which has already won the world manufacturer's title for the company. It's four-wheel drive, using a smaller version of the same engine as the Group C car, 6.2 litres, 500 brake horsepower. If it goes into production, it'll be the fastest road car in the world. Informed opinion has it that could very well be 5 years. It could also prove to be little more than a somewhat spectacular show car. Not so this, the XJR9, which has done quite a lot of damage around the world this year, in the company of course, the world sports car champion, Martin Brundle. Martin, congratulations.
Thank you, Richard.
What's she like to drive?
It's fast. We were clocked at 242 miles an hour through the race this year at Le Mans, down the Mulsanne straight. That's fast enough.
And noisy?
Not too bad. We're wearing crash helmet, of course, and air plugs, but it gets very hot in there. Basically, we're sitting in a heat pump to go that fast.
Your decision to leave Formula One, Jaguars to pump as much money as they have done into the sport, the success this year vindicates both?
Yes, the money side from Jaguar, of course, the team is very well sponsored all around the world. From my point of view, I took a gamble on my Formula One career to move into sports cars, but not a gamble, of course, to join Jaguar and TWR. It's a great team. We've had a lot of success this year, and I'm very proud to have been part of it.
Yes, haven't you, Jasper? But what of the future? Been a lot of speculation about what you do next.
Yes, just a few moments ago, I signed a commitment with Jaguar for 1989, such that if I do sports car racing, as and when I do them, then I'll be in a Jaguar. That's subject to any Formula One plans that I may have, but I'm hoping to defend my world championship in a Jaguar.
Well, they've been queuing in the aisles just to catch a glimpse of this XJ220 since it was unveiled on Tuesday. It really has proved to be the star of the show, so it's an extremely privileged position that I'm in sitting here. It climaxes a marvellous year for Jaguar. They've picked up 5 awards at the show, including the Horner Trophy for the best concept car, and there's something of an irony in that because this car has gone beyond that stage. And what can I tell you about it? Well, it would be silly of me to start to discuss what is and isn't here. It's more a question of what is. Sweeping instrument panel around and into the doors. It's finished beautifully in leather, which isn't usually the case when you get to the road racer end of the market. The more you look at it, the more you love it. And the more you sit here, the more you want it.
Never mind feasting your eyes on the car of the present, how about this? You're not going to find this in your local showroom, because this is Renault's idea of the car of the future. And the statistics involved with this car are positively mind-boggling. Try 62 electric motors, or how about 12 kilos of electronic compositions, as they say in France, or 16 kilometers of cable. What it really means is it's less of a car and more of a playground, and the price, an estimated 20 million. That is in francs, but even with today's exchange rate, doesn't sound awfully favourable. But there's fun to be had in this. If Renault were right, motoring in the future is going to be an absolute picnic. With the touch of a button, the passenger seat slides back, so there's absolutely tons of legroom for your favourite auntie. And with the touch of another button down here by the driver's seat, the boot lifts up. Absolutely no effort at all in that. And inside is a really good device, something I wish was in cars now. The boot itself slides out like the drawer in a chest of drawers, and of course slides back in. Much easier to put your cases in. But it's inside the car that the real fun is to be had, because this car nearly drives for you. It certainly gets you into the right driving position and closes the door for you when you want. And the steering wheel is adjustable too, which is a great idea. It means you can get the steering wheel up or down to the perfect driving position. Isn't that sophisticated? Talking of sophistication, with cars today, of course, you have to choose whether you want manual or automatic transmission when you buy them. With this car, you can choose when you drive it. That's what this little gear stick's for. Manual, automatic, and a 5-speed gearbox, and that is what I call a sporty little gear stick. There's a cassette down here, which you can program with, say, a roadmap of Paris, whatever you might need. Of course, there's a CD player. And if the passengers in the back have had enough of you wittering on about which is the best route to choose, all their problems can be solved at the touch of a button. There's a video screen in the back. This is all very nice indeed. In fact, I think it's a shame that Richard and Chris can't have a look round. I wonder what's happened to them. Oh, by Jove, I might have guessed it. They're on telly. Hey, that was quick. I've just seen you.
It's beautiful, isn't it? Quick word about Mike Smith, who really wanted to be here to take part in this programme this week, but couldn't. It was just a bit too soon after the accident. Get well soon, Smithy, and of course give Sarah Green our love too.
Don't forget, from now on the show is only £4. It's very good value, and there's an awful lot here to see.
That's it from us. Bye-bye now.
Bye.
Bye-bye.